So let's start. So my name is Sebas Sadlu. I'm an MFA creative writing student and a teaching fellow at St. Mary's College. And I'm honored to be here today to present our distinguished guest. Before that, I want to thank a few people. First of all, Professor Ahmadi, the Department of Near Eastern Studies, who made this event possible. Secondly, I would like to thank Robert Hass and Brenda Hillman for being here today. It's really an honor to have you. They need no introduction, so I'm not going to do that. And last but not least, I want to thank all of you guys for being here. So it's normally easier to do, this without note, but I had to prepare a note for today. So when I learned I was supposed to introduce today's guest, the first thought that occurred to me was, how would you introduce someone who has taught you everything? So I'm just borrowing words from my mentor to do this introduction. Mahmoud Rezvani was born on March 29, 1954. He is what many who have been lucky enough to be his protege, myself included, would refer to as the Renaissance man, for his profound knowledge and wealth of experience in territories that range from fine arts to martial arts, from music to medical terminology, and from mathematics to economics. He sculpts fresh figures out of his fledgling students, much like Michelangelo, and shapes them with artistry, much like Leonardo da Vinci. He has been teaching translation, simultaneous interpretation, etymology, and classical Persian literature for 45 years. As he himself said in an interview back in 2010, quote, teaching is my raison d'etre, and learning my joie de vivre, end quote. Dr. Rezvani has taught at countless schools, institutions, and organizations. Among them are Tehran University of Medical Sciences and Pasteur Institute of Iran, an epicenter of advanced medical research. For the last 20 years alone, he has been teaching at the Simultaneous Interpretation Preparatory Courses Institute, where he is also the managing director. In addition, he is a visiting speaker at UNESCO Center in Iran and Tehran University's Faculty of Foreign Languages. His approach to teaching, much like his approach to living, is drenched in improvisation, mnemonics, carpe diem, and last but not least, comedy. When the staff of a Danish educational TV channel who had videotaped one of his classes asked him to describe his teaching method in one word, his reply was, clownsmanship. He has served as the editor-in-chief at Reuters Commodities News in Iran for 2 years, and was formerly the Secretary General of the Iranian Translators Association. More than 7 years ago, he embarked on doing what the Persian literati considered to be a task impossible to accomplish, a translation of Sa'di's book Golestan, or The Rose Garden, that would be both accurate and graceful. Dr. Rezvani's translation was recently endorsed by UNESCO, who have offered to be its exclusive publisher. It will also be officially announced as a work of cultural heritage in a ceremony at Tehran's Saadawat Palace. I just want to read a very, very short poem from Sa'di's book Golestan that was translated by Dr. Rezvani. That it says, پادشاهی پسر به مکتب داد لوح سیمینش در کنار نهاد بر سر لوح او نوشته به زر جور استاد به مهر پدر. Here's the translation. Once upon a time, a king sent his son to school. He laid beside him a silver slate as a writing tool. Atop the slate, the king had these words written in gold. Better than the father's affection is the teacher's instruction, though harsh and bold. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my munificent mentor, Mahmoud Rezvani.
Thank you very much. Since I don't want to be accused of ingratitude, so I thank you too. Anyway, So we have always been faced with a nettlesome question, and that is the question of Genesis. Where have I come from? Where am I going to? And so far, no satisfactory answer has been found to this vexatious question. And bewildered as we are trying to find an answer. Some people say it is biogenesis, life stems from life. Some people say no, it is abiogenesis. They believe in spontaneous generation. And while in desperation, everybody says something, and for that reason, we are so much absorbed by these supernatural powers and ESP, extrasensory perception, things like sixth sense, telepathy, mind reading, intuition, clairvoyance, psychokinesis, and so forth. And above all, divination. This is what I'm going to talk about now. Divination is the art or practice of foreseeing or foretelling the future through different means. In some societies, they do it through pyromancy, through fire, like primitive societies. Some societies, they do it through necromancy, that is conjuration of the spirits of the dead. Some people by chiromancy, that was necromancy, they do it by chiromancy, palmistry. But bibliomancy is a common, it's a very common practice in my country. That is divination by means of books. But what are these books that are used for this purpose? There are two ones, actually, the major ones. One is the Holy Quran, and the other one is the Book of Hafiz. But my father was an iconoclast. He was a nonconformist. He did something quite unorthodox. He used the Book of Sa'di. We had a corpus at home. You know, his corpus consists of different segments. One of them is Tayyibat, the one that we use for this purpose. You know, I believe he was an innate psychologist. He never urged me or pushed me into doing that. He said, okay, let us see what's got, let me first tell you what this bibliomancy works. Imagine you are on the horns of a dilemma. You're in a twilight zone. You have a hard choice to make. You really need someone to give you an advice. You need to consult someone or something. So generally you refer to this book. I mean, you randomly choose one of the poems and then you try to interpret and you try to find your answer in it. Of course, obviously sometimes the choice is already made. For instance, if somebody has proposed to you and you want to see whether you should say yes or no, well, you do that. But already you have made the choices. The person is handsome and rich. You've already said yes. You try to find something that says yes. And the other way around. Anyway, of course, these are not scientific. This is not science. It is not even pseudoscience. But anyway, it's amusing. And we're curious to know what's going to happen in the future. And my father, knowing that, would arouse my curiosity. He never told me to read. He said, okay, bring the book. I said, okay, this is the book. Let's see what's going to happen to your uncle's business. Let's see what's going to happen to your cousin's education. Let's see. I love to satisfy my curiosity. So then I would read again and again, more and more and more. This is how the fetus of this love was conceived in me. And then years later, when I started learning English, and I don't know whether I've learned or not. So I said, I used to. And I became familiar with the name. I heard that name very often, Edward Fitzgerald, the one who has translated the Rubais, the Quatrains of Khayyam. Very enthusiastically, I got a copy. And with sort of unbridled voracity, I tried to imbibe every drop in that. But to my astonishment, or rather disappointment, I found that it was not a translation of Khayyam. It was not even a liberal translation.
You know, this gentleman has actually translated the philosophy of Khayyam. You know, his philosophy is carpe diem, seize the day. But of course, we say seize the moment. In his quatrains, there is always a confrontation between hedonism and Puritanism. You know, hedonists say we are born to enjoy. Puritans say we are born to suffer. And any sort of enjoyment is a sin. And they say even marriage must be for the sake of reproduction and procreation. And if you enjoy, you're a sinner. These gentlemen, I don't know, these people seem not to understand the difference between voluntary and involuntary. Enjoy is not something that you try to. Anyway, but he has translated the philosophy, not the words. You know, you can by no means maintain a one-to-one correspondence between the Persian version and Mr. Edward Fitzgerald's translation. It is just a liberal translation. But whatever he has done, as an Iranian person, I'm indebted to him, quite beholden. He did something. They say the only impeccable writers are those that never wrote. So he wrote. So that's why he made mistakes. So, you know, sometimes people say, oh, so Mr. Somebody fell down. I say, well, implicitly it means that he was running or walking. You never fall down because you were sleeping all the time and you were not expected to fall. Anyway, I got other copies of other illustrious poets we have, like Maulana, who's falsely called Rumi. He's not Rumi. He's not from Rum. He's from Balkh. Balkh is a place, and right now it is a part of Afghanistan. But at that time, it was a part of Iran. I mean, because centuries ago, Iran was invaded by the Mongols. And these people had to flee for safety. And seeking a safe haven, they traveled all the way from northeastern part of Iran to all the way to northwestern, to where Turkey is now. And he died there. The fact that he's buried there doesn't mean that he's from there. He's not Rumi. That's a false name. Anyway, I got a copy of this and from Hafez and all that. And then I noticed that, well, they were translations, but the translator had not done justice to that. And then I asked myself another question. How is it that Goethe, the German poet, is so much in love with Hafez, or Emerson, the American essayist and poet, is so much in love with Saadi and portrays him as if he were preternatural or celestial? Of course he is. And then I asked myself, did he really plumb the unfathomable mysteries found in their poetry? Of course not. With those translations, no. So what would have happened if they had found a better translation? Then I loved to do something, but it was just an ambitious toddler aspiring to conquer the Everest. But anyway, aspirations. Everybody has hopes and aspirations. It's not a sin. Then there were some big name literati in Iran. They told me, they urged me, they said, you were the one to do what? It's incumbent upon you to do it. You must do it. This is you who can do it. And they kept telling me this. And I said, okay, I will. So as the first step, I got two of the translations of Gulistan. This is what I had in mind to do. One of them was done by a British gentleman called James Ross. The other one by a Polish gentleman called Edward Rohatsik. The second one, I'm sorry to say, is even below mediocre. That is not even a very good copy of the first one. It's a copy of that, but it's an awkward copy. I said, I really don't know why the gentleman did this. He didn't have to. But Mr. Ross, James Ross, the British man, his English was apparently good. He knew good English. Even, no, not everybody who is British necessarily knows English. No, that's not. Right. All right. Anyway, but he did a good job. I mean, he was good. I mean, his anger in some parts, whenever it is supposed to be stilted, it is stilted. It over elegant, even pompous and bombastic, whatever, whenever it is needed. But there are certain shortcomings, not negligible ones, very tough ones. Number one, I mean, just one of them, is misunderstanding. He misunderstood the word. And this misunderstanding is simply because of the amphibologies, and ambiguities that we have in those days. He didn't understand it. I mean, some of these sentences are truly open to misconstruction. And they misconstrued them. Probably they had every right to do so, because it's so complicated. And you know, Sa'di's style is supposed to be perspicuous, yet impossible. It's exactly where perspicuity and perplexity meet. It sounds paradoxical, but it is what it is. That is Sa'di. So they misconstrued it. This is the first thing. The second problem was their problem, his problem actually, with homographs. Homographs, you know, they're words that are written the same but have different meanings. You know, we have, for example, the word in Farsi, Can'an, which in English it is Canaan, C-A-N-A-A-N. Canaan has two meanings. One is a place, a region where it is Palestine now. And Joseph, Prophet Joseph, is from Canaan, and his father Jacob. This is one meaning. Another one, Noah, Prophet Noah's son, the one who's said to have gone astray, I don't know, and repudiated and disowned by the father. So his name was Canaan too. In one of the stories, Sa'di explicitly says, I'm talking about Noah's son, but he has translated the region, the territory. I don't know why. And you can imagine how preposterous the result was. See, this is about homographs. Another problem is problems with heteronyms. Heteronyms are words that are spelt the same but pronounced differently. Just like in English, you have B-A-S-S. If you pronounce it bass, it's a kind of fish. If it is bass, it is low pitch in music. And just imagine if you take one for the other, what will happen? And this is exactly one of the sort of mistakes they made. We have the word mu'lam. Mu'lam means variegated, means colorful, flamboyant, embellished, you know, that is ornate. So we have, here, mu'lam, right? And we have mu'allim, which is teacher. Sa'di says, dibaya mu'lam, means variegated brocade. But he translated teacher's brocade. I mean, that was an adjective. This is a noun. And these two are poles apart. What do you mean by that? I mean, he made mistakes with that. This is another one, another group of actually. I have classified. Another one, another type, is another actually group of mistakes, is mistakes with allusions. You know, literature and history are inextricably interrelated, interwoven. You cannot learn one without the other. It's symbolic. We have a lot of these things in Farsi, a lot. In Sa'di's Golestan, you know, this book is replete with allusions. This word alludes to a certain verse in the Holy Quran. This one alludes to a story about Jesus Christ. This one alludes to this, the full of allusions. For example, it's a چرا دامن آلوده را حد زنم چو در خود شناسم که تر دامنم. It's a story of Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene. You know, it's cast not the first stone. It's a story of that. See, we need to know this. So you'll have to know to understand what it is about. And a lot of things. We have allusion to some traditions attributed to Prophet Muhammad. And a lot. You'll have to be familiar with them to translate it the way you should. The other thing with us is, you know, we have connotations. We have problems with connotations. There are certain words in Saudi, they seem to be synonymous, but they are not. They have different connotations. For example, one of them is, for example, Zahid. Zahid is a person who is hypocritically biased. He is sanctimonious. He preaches, but does not practice it. And in closet, he does whatever that is forbidden. So it's a negative word. But we have Abed. This one is a recluse, like hermits. You know, they retreat. They go to a corner. They live in seclusion. And from morning to night, they keep praying and all that. And Saadi criticizes them too. He says, what's the whole purpose of all these prostrations and genuflections? You were just, this is sheer egoism. What about altruism? What about philanthropy? What about humanitarianism? You're just thinking about yourself. You're selfish. There is another one, that is Aref. These people are meditative. They are more, they're meditating, contemplating. They're more into contemplation and meditation. And of course, I'm just talking about this briefly. And also we have Rend. Rend has a positive and a negative connotation. The negative one is a sly, cunning. In everyday dialogue we use it, Rend. He's cunning. But Rend is actually at the apex of this pyramid of purification and edification. These people are free thinkers. They can tolerate no shackles, no fetters. They said we are free as a bird. They're just libertine and all that. And in that case, it's a positive one. So these are the, well, there are some other mistakes. And another one, actually, the figures of speech. They're totally ignored in those things. I mean, Saadi's major figure of speech, a prominent one, is called in Golestan. It's called Saj, which is rhyming prose. And you know, rhyming prose falls into three different categories: parallel, symmetrical, lopsided. And they're all ignored. And they haven't done that. In Saadi's Golestan, there are eight different chapters. And these chapters, the first chapter is on the behavior of the kings, on the behavior of kings. The second one is on the morals of dervishes, then on the virtues of contentment, on the benefits of silence, on love and youth, on decrepitude and old age, and on the effects of education, and rules of companionship. These are what they are about. Now I will read some of them. Okay. By the way, do you understand Farsi? Some of you, yeah, some of you, all right. So shall I read it in Farsi too, right? Okay, thank you. Dr. Haas says yes. Okay. The first thing I will read, or at least you can realize what a Farsi sound like. Is it euphonious, cacophonous, what? Anyway, so the first one I would read is, it's about kings. He's advising them. He's telling them, hey, Mr. Ruler, myriads of people like you have come and gone, and nobody even knows their name. They are forgotten. If you want to be immortal, there is one way. That is dispense justice. That's the only way to immortalize yourself. And there is a king among the Sasanid dynasty from those, dynasty. His name is Anushirvan. He's famous for his justice. That's what we have it in this. So, Basnam var bezir zamin dafn kardan. کس هستیش به روی زمین بر نشان نماند. وان پیر لاشه را که سپردن زیر گل، خاکش چنان بخورد که از او استخوان نماند. زنده است نام فرخ نوشیروان به خیر، گرچه بسی گذشت که نوشیروان نماند. خیری کن ای فلان و غنیمت شمار عمر، زان پیشتر که بانگ برایت فلان نماند.
And now this is a translation. Inhumed is many a luminary, no trace of whom is left. And that old carcass committed to the dust is so consumed not a shard of bone is left. Notwithstanding years have elapsed since Nosheirvan's demise, in good repute his renown is left. Be munificent, O thou, and avail thyself of life. Long before the cry is raised, thou hast perished, and nothing is left.
That was the first. The second one I'm going to read, it's a debate between a standard, a banner, and a curtain. Weird, right? Right. But it is. Yeah, you can find anything in literature. Right. So that's that. Right, things that are not weird, you can find it in physics or geometry. But yeah. So this is so beautiful. It says in hikayat shenu ke dar Baghdad rayat o parde ra khilaf uftad. Rayat az gard rah o ranj rakab goft ba parde az tariq etab. Man o to har do khaje tashanim bande bargah sultanim. Man ze khidmat dami nayasudam gah o bigah dar safar budam. تو نه رنج آزموده ای نه حسار، نه بیابان و باد و گرد و غبار. قدم من به سعی پیشتر است، پس چرا عزت تو بیشتر است؟ تو بر بندگان محرویی، با غلامان یاسمن بویی. من فتاده به دست شاگردان، به سفر پای بند و سرگردان. گفت، گفت، من سر بر آستان دارم، نه چطو سر بر آسمان دارم. هر که بیهوده گردن افرازد، خیشتن را به گردن اندازد. Listen to what once occurred in Baghdad, the dispute between a curtain and a standard. Anent the road dust and the stirrups irritation, the standard told the curtain by way of vituperation. Thou and I are servants of the same Lord, to the king's court fastened by one cord. Never have I been relieved from duty, every so often on a trip, ugly or of beauty. Thou hast neither toil nor siege sustained, thyself neither against wilderness and wind, nor dust and dirt maintained. In endeavor, my step surpasses thine. Then why is thy dignity more than mine? Thou art with the moon-faced maids, injurious the company of jasmine-scenting aids. I have fallen into the hands of the vagrants and of the servants, bound to travel like vagrants. The curtain said, humble I lay my head at the threshold, but thou holdest thine heavenwards and bold. He who sticks out his neck in vain will only incur others' disdain.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Well, now, just as an example for, okay, there is another poem I read it. This will sound something like Titanic. Right. It's about a lover and his sweetheart. They fall into the sea and all that. So, yeah, very. So, جوانی پاک باز و پاک رو بود که با پاکیز روی در کرو بود. کرو is a kind of bow. چنین خواندم که در دریای اعظم به گردابی در افتادند با هم. چون الله آمدش تا دست گیرد مبادا کاندر آن حالت بمیرد. بگفت از میان همی گفت از میان موج و تشویر مرا بگذار و دست یار من گیر. در این گفتن جهان بر وی برآشفت شنیدندش که جان میداد و میگفت حدیث عشق از آن بطال منیوش که در سختی کند یاری فراموش. چنین کردند یاران زندگانی ز کار افتاده بشنو تا بدانی که سعدی را و رسم عشق بازی چنان داند که در بغداد تازی. دلارامی که داری دل برو بند دگر دل از همه عالم فرو بند و چشم از همه عالم فرو بند. اگر مجنون لیلی زنده گشتی حدیث عشق از این دفتر نوشتی. You know, مجنون is a famous lover and Layli, the beloved. There once was a youth, handsome and well disposed, sitting with a damsel on a vessel, calm and composed. I have read that sailing on the great sea, happy and cool, suddenly together they fell into a whirlpool. As the sailor attempted to hold his hand, lest he might die in that lay of the land, he kept saying from the midst of the waves and distress, let go of me and rescue my mistress. While saying this, his world fell into disarray. With his dying breath, he was heard to say, hear not the story of love from that man of atrocity, who will forget the beloved in time of adversity. Thus we're leading alive the true lovers. Learn it from an old hand who everything covers. As a weary Saadi of all the ins and outs of lovemaking, as an Arab in Baghdad deems speaking Arabic so easy an undertaking. To the heart consoler thou hast, tie thy heart. Let thy eyes be shut to any other sweetheart. Should Majnun of Layli come back from the dead, he would let go of his love story and copy this one instead. Thank you. So learn it. Don't say, hold my hand and let go of my mistress. Right. So, there is another one. Well, there are lots of these. This one is, I just read it, this is short, for the sake of the Saj, as I said, rhyming prose. It says, توانگر فاسق کلوخ زرندود است و درویش صالح شاهد خاک‌آلود. این دلق موسی است مرقع و آن ریش فرعون مرصع. See, it just rhymes, you can feel it right. A vicious rich man is a piece of cloth gold garnished, and a virtuous dervish is a sweetheart soil tarnished. This being the cloak of Moses, having patched rents, and that one the beard of Pharaoh, adorned with ornaments. See, I like this one. As I say, gold, you say that is a piece of cloth, gold garnished, a sweetheart, soil tarnished. This is what we mean by that. Or one for the musicality. No, it says, Darun favane javani, chenan ke oftadodani. See? در آن فوان جوانی چنان که افتد و دانی با شاهدی سری و سری داشتم. سری سری. See heteronyms. به حکمان که حلقی داشت طیب الادا و خلقی کالبطر ازا قدا. These are Arabic, actually.
So, just, I read this part for the sake of this musicality. In the prime of my youth, as it happens and you know forsooth. See, that is. In the prime of my youth, as it happens and you know forsooth, with a handsome sweetheart, I held a secret and a romance in the closet. For his throat created a melodious tune, and his face was as beautiful as the full moon. See, that is, yeah.
Okay, and right, another one for this purpose, as I said. Okay, I read that. So, پادشاه باید کتاب حدی خشم بر دشمنان براند نرانه. پادشاه باید کتاب حدی خشم بر دشمنان نراند که دوستان را اعتماد نماند. آتش خشم اول در خداوند خشم افتد. پس آنگه زبانه به خصم رسد یا نرسد. نشاید بنی آدم خاکزاد که در سر کند کبر و تندی و باد. تو را با چنین گرمی و سرکشی نپندارم از خاکی از آتشی. A king is not to unleash his wrath upon his foes to the extent that his friends might lose confidence. The flurries of wrath would first fall upon the one who vents it. Then they may or may not reach the foe. It is not becoming the children of Adam made of dust, harbor in their heads arrogance, wrath, and lust. I reckon with such obstinacy and desire, thou art not made of dust, but fire.
Thank you. Again, this one for the sake of that rhyming prose.
Said تلمیز بی ارادت عاشق بی زر است و رونده بی معرفت مرغ بی پر و عالم بی عمل درخت بی بر و ظاهر بی علم خانه بی در.
See, just the music.
So, a student who is not diligent is a lover who is indigent. And a traveler who has lost his bearings is a bird having no wings. And a scholar not practicing his knowledge is a tree having no fruit but foliage. And a pious person lacking the true knowledge of religious jurisprudence is a house without an entrance.
Okay.
And this is a story about congeniality. Well, as you know, we have something in our literature. It's congeniality versus consanguinity. Congeniality versus propinquity. The fact that two people are consanguineous, they're related by blood, does it necessarily mean that they're related or they're close? No, they're not at all. So we say it's a matter of congeniality, not propinquity, not consanguinity. Here there's a story about a crow and a parrot. They're not birds of a feather. So, right. Do you remember in Aristocats, birds of a feather hiccup together? It was not, right. So, that is, توتی با زاغ در قفس کردند و از قبح مشاهده او مجاهده می برد و می گفت این چه طلعت مکروه است و هیئت ممقوت و منظر ملعون و شمایل ناموزون یا غراب البین یا لیت بینی و بینک بعد المشرقین علی الصباح به روی تو هر که برخیزد صباح روز سلامت بر او مسا باشد بدختری چو تو در صحبت تو بایستی ولی چون این که تویی در جهان کجا باشد عجب آن که قراب از مجاورت توتی هم به جان آمده بود و ملول شده لاحول کنان از گردش گیتی همی نالید و دست های تقابان بر یک دیگر همی مالید که این چه بخت نگون است طالع دون و ایام بوقلمون. لایق قدر من آنستی که با زاغی به دیوار باقی برخرامان همی رفتمی. پارسا را بس اینقدر زندان که بود هم طویله رندان. ولی تا چه کردم که روزگارم به عقوبت آن در سلک صحبت چنین ابلهی خود رای ناجنس خیره درای به چنین بهن مبتلا گردانیده است. کس نیاید به پای دیواری که بران صورتت نگار کنند. گر تو را در بهشت باشد جای دیگران دوزخ اختیار کنند. این ضرب المثل بدان آوردم تا بدانی که صد چندان که دانا را از نادان نفرت است، نادان را از دانا وحشت است. زاهدی در سماع رندان بود، زان میان گفت شاهدی بلخی، گر ملولی زما ترش منشین، که تو هم در میان ما تلخی. جمعی گل و لال، جمعی چو گل و لاله به هم پیوسته، تو هیزم خشک در میانی رسته، چون باد مخالف و چون سرما ناخوش، چون برف نشسته ای و چون یخ بسته. Okay, I read that. They shut up a parrot and a crow in the same cage. The parrot was disgusted at the crow's disagreeable look and said, "What a hideous face and odious visage. What an accursed feature and ungraceful figure. O raven of separation, would that you and I were wide apart from each other as the east is from the west. To one who wakes up in the morning seeing thee, the morning of the day of peace, but a night will be. In thy company, an ominous entity like thyself should be, but where on earth could one find an existence like thee? Strange as it may seem, the crow too was bored and vexed to the soul at the society of the parrot. Bewildered, wringing the hands of chagrin, it kept bewailing the revolutions of the heavens, saying, what an unpropitious fate, ominous luck, and capricious time. It would befit my dignity to strut with another crow on the wall of a garden. To the pious, it would be no less than incarceration to be bound to tolerate the libertine's association. Yes, what sin have I committed in retribution of which the destiny has immured me to suffer the companion companionship of such an idiot, egomaniacal, uncongenial blabber. No one would approach the foot of a wall on which thy portrait is painted as a fresco. Wert thou to dwell in paradise, to hell others would prefer to go. I related this parable so that you know however much the learned hate the ignorant, 100 times more the ignorant are scared of the learned. A man of piety was at the libertine's revelry. There asserted someone from Balch, handsome and smart, if thou art displeased with us, sit not sour. So among us too, thou art bitter and tart. An assembly of roses and tulips tied together. Amongst them thou art like a piece of firewood doomed to wither. Like the frost unpleasant and the wind biting in adverse weather. Like the frozen and snow fallen hither and thither. Like the ice frozen and snow fallen hither and thither. Okay. So this one is a small one that is right. Under, okay. دو کس رنج بیهوده بردند و سعی بیفایده کردند. یکی آنکه اندوخت و نخورد و دیگر آنکه آموخت و نکرد. علم چندان که بیش در خانی چون عمل در تو نیست نادانی. نه محقق بود نه دانشمند. چارپایی بر او کتابی چند. آن توهی مغز را چه علم و خبر که بر او هیزم است یا دفتر. در از Two individuals suffered useless pain and endeavored in vain. He who hoarded wealth and did not spend it, and the other one who acquired knowledge and did not practice it. However much knowledgeable thou mayest be, thou art ignorant if there is no practice in thee. He is neither a sage nor a scientist, only a load of books carried by a beast. No knowledge has that beast of burden, whether with firewood or book it is laden. Okay. Thank you. So, thank you. Right. Just a very small one. So, عالم ناپرهیزگار کور مشعله دار است. That is, a learned man who is intemperate resembles a torch bearer who is blind. See? A learned man who is intemperate resembles a torch bearer who is blind. He who squanders his life in vain loses his gold, but nothing does he gain. That's a small one. Okay. And now, we always have, there is a confrontation between the souls that we have. One is called the soul imperative, or despotic soul. The other one is the reproachful soul. The reproachful soul is actually superego, or conscience, is to say. So there is always a confrontation between these two. There is some money here. A call from within says, this is not yours, of course, the money is somebody's. And a call from within says, take it, take it. What is that? The wise soul. That is a soul imperative. Yeah, it's that way. They say it's more delicious, the forbidden, huh? I said, why is it that everything that I enjoy is either illegal, immoral, or fattening? Right, so it's always like that, right? So, that's it. So that we have a reproachful soul is the superego. They said, no, this is not yours. This is not yours. The stupid soul. So here there is a confrontation. There is a confrontation between these two. And a person, a recluse, they ask him, you know, he has retreated to a cave. I'll read it. And they ask him, how come you're there? He says, I cannot guarantee that if I go to the city, I can remain chaste. That is chastity by force. Chastity in seclusion or something. He says, I don't know. I cannot guarantee that I will remain there. So it's like, if I'm there, if I'm a recluse, if I'm in a corner somewhere, it's simply because I cannot resist that. It is irresistible. So he says, بزرگی دیدم اندر کوه ساری قناعت کرده از دنیا به غاری. چرا گفتم به شهر اندر نیایی که باری بندی از دل برگشایی. بگفت آنجا پری رویان نغزند چو گل بسیار شد پیلان بلبزند. In the mountains I witnessed a man holy and grave. Of all the earthly pleasures, contented with a cave. Why, I said, wouldst thou not for the city depart, so thou couldst relax the bonds of thy heart? There dwell fairy face, sweethearts, he did rumble. Where there is too much mud, even elephants will stumble.
Right. And the water of immortality. Right.
So that is also, there is Musa alayhi salam, Qarun ran. Are you getting tired?
No, we are not getting tired, we are already tired. No, it's like, get is a stage before to be. First we get, then we are. Right, priority. Get, become. But once a teacher, always a teacher. Yeah, so. They say Musa alayhi salam Qarun ra nasihat kard ke ahsan kama ahsan Allah alayk nashnid o aqibat shanidi. An kas ke be dinar o dirham khair nayandukht sar aqibat an dar sar dinar o dirham kard. Khahi ke mumatta shavi az dunya o aqba ba khalq karam kun cho khoda ba to karam kard. Arab guyat jot wala tumnan tamnan. فَإِنَّ الْفَائِدَةَ إِلَيْكَ قَائِدَ یعنی ببخش و منت منه که نفع آن به تو باز می‌گردد. درخت کرم هر کجا بیخ کرد گذشت از فلک شاخ و بالای او گر امیدواری که از او برخوری به منت منه اره بر پای او. Moses, may peace be upon him, exhorted Qarun. Qarun is Croesus, king of Lydia, who's famous for his wealth. You know, in Farsi, they call him Qarun, but it's Croesus, or they say Korah or Croesus. Moses, may peace be upon him, exhorted Qarun, saying, be bounteous as God has been bounteous to you. He did not listen, and you have heard the end of him. Whoever with his dinars and dirhams did not engage in acts of charity, would eventually lose his head for the sake of that cupidity. If in both worlds thou wishest to enjoy prosperity, be generous to others as thou enjoyest God's generosity. Arabs say, bestow, but do not exact an obligation, as the benefit thereof will return to you. Wherever the tree of munificence grows roots, beyond the skies will go its trunk, boughs, and shoots. If thou art desirous to enjoy its fruits, lay not a soul upon its trunk by obligations and such moods. Thank you.
Thank you. This one is about secrets. Never reveal your secrets to anybody, even to your friends, because they have friends too, and so on. That's it. See, that is, هر آن سری که داری با دوست در میان منه. چه دانی که وقتی دشمن گردد و هر گزندی که توانی به دشمن مرسان که باشد که وقتی دوست شود. رازی که نهان خواهی با کس در میان منه، وگرچه دوست مخلص باشد، که مران دوست را نیز دوستان مخلص باشد، همچنین مسلسل. خاموشی به که ضمیر دل خیش با کسی گفتن که مگوی، ای سلیم آبز سرچشمه ببند، که چپر شد نتوان بستن جوی. سخنی در ده نهان نباید گفت که بر انجمن نشاید گفت. Okay. Do not divulge every secret that you have to a friend. You never know. Someday he may become an enemy. And do not inflict every harm that you can upon an enemy, as he may become a friend someday. Do not reveal to anyone a secret that you wish to keep concealed.
even though he's a sincere friend, as sincere friends may have sincere friends too, and so on. Better be silent than reveal thy heart to someone and ask him not to impart. O simpleton, confine the spring at the source. Once it overflows, one cannot change the course. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, though. Okay. In secret, no word should be told that in public thou canst not unfold.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Well, it's good to relieve the monotony. Okay. Then we have, right. Mulch as kharadmandan jamal girat, va din as parhizgaran kamal yabat. Padishahan be sohbat kharadmandan az an mohtaj taran ke kharadmandan be qurbat padishahan. Pandi agar بشنوی ای پادشاه در همه عالم به از این پند نیست جز به خردمند مفرما عمل گرچه عمل کار خردمند نیست.
Okay. A territory is decorated by the sagacious and religion is consummated by the virtuous. Kings stand in need of the company of the sagacious more than the sagacious need the society of kings. O king, if thou wilt listen to a piece of my mind, in the whole world a better one thou canst not find. Entrust not thy affairs save to the sage, though they are not supposed to engage in tasks of that kind.
And there is one, this is about bribery, about corruptible judges. It means that even centuries ago, judges were corruptible or something. So it runs in history or something. So venal judges or something. And in Farsi, they call it shirini. Shirini means sweets, but here means bribe. So when say shirini be them is give me some. That's it. Hame kas ra dandan be torshi kon shavad magar qazian ra ke be shirini. Qazi cho be rishvat bekhorad panj khiyar sabet konad az bahr to dah kharboz zar. That is, the teeth of all men get blunted by acids, but those of the judges by sweets. For a bribe of 5 cucumbers, a judge as a bribee will rule in the court that 10 melon fields belong to thee.
Right.
Yes. Now, a longer one. So this, I don't read the Farsi because it's a little bit, right. I read the English, I just tell you briefly what it is. There is an old man, I don't know whether you can call him old or not, he's 150 years old. Yeah, and, right, he's 150 years old and he's moribund, he's dying, and the story goes, then you will see what the story is about. In the Cathedral Mosque of Damascus, I was engaged in a disputation with a number of learned men. When a youth stepped in and asked, "Is there anybody among you who knows the Persian language?" The majority pointed at me. I told him, "I hope you are the bearer of good news." He replied, "An old man of 150 years of age is moribund, and he's saying something in the Persian language, and we don't understand it. If you be kind enough to take the trouble to come, your favor will be remunerated.
Perhaps he's going to make his last will. When I sat down by his beside, he kept saying this. I had wished to live for a few moments as I desired. After 150 years, a few moments. I had wished to live for a few moments as I desire. Alas, I'm breathing my last and it is time to expire. Alas, at the variegated table of life, they shouted enough before I had partaken of what I aspire. I explained in Arabic to the Syrians the meaning of what he had said. And they were astounded at his longevity together with regret for this earthly life. I said, how do you feel in this state? He replied, what shall I say? When a tooth is being extracted from a man's jaw, hast thou not witnessed what torture he sustains? Now imagine in what state he will be at the moment the soul departs and the body remains. Don't visualize. I said, abandon all thoughts of death and don't let delusion subdue your nature. As the Greek philosophers have said, although the temperaments may be healthy, our survival cannot be guaranteed. And an ailment, though pernicious, will not necessarily be conducive to death. If you will give me leave, I will call in a physician to treat you. He opened his eyes, smiled, and said, seeing the fallen fellow decrepit and unaware, the veteran physician smites the hands of despair. The landlord's concern is the peristyle's decoration while the house is run down from the foundation. A moribund old man was moaning and groaning in pain while his old wife was anointing him with sandalwood in vain. Should imbalance of temperament prevail, neither incantation nor medication would avail.
Thank you.
Right.
Yes. Yeki do this is small, sorry, Rita. Okay. So Yeki do stirak zaman hana di de wood gov kojai ke moshtaq budam gov moshtaqi beke maluli. Dir amadi ay negar sarmast zudat nadahin daman az dast. معشوقه که دیر دیر بینند آخر کم از آن که سیر بینند.
One said to a friend whom he had not met for ages, where have you been? I have been so solicitous about you. He replied, to be fired up is better than to be fed up. Yeah. Thou hast come late, O intoxicating sweetheart. Holding on to thy skirt, I shall not drift apart. Wert thou to see thy beloved once in a blue moon, to enjoy thy fill at least, would sure be a boon.
Okay.
Okay. بزرگی را پرسیدند با چندین فضیلت که دست راست را هست خاتم در انگشت چپ چرا کنم؟ گفت ندانستی که اهل فضیلت همیشه محروم باشند؟ آن که هز آفرید و روزی داد یا فضیلت همی دهد یا بخت.
They asked the great man, notwithstanding all the excellence that the right hand possesses, why is it that they wear the ring on the left one?
He replied, don't you know that the meritorious are always deprived?
He who bestows upon us shares and provisions,
either wisdom and virtue or good luck apportions.
One of them. Right.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to be immortal. Water of immortality. So, right. That is فریب دشمن مخور و غرور ملاح مخر که این دام رزق نهاده است و آن دامن طمع گشاده. احمق را ستایش خوش آید چون لاشه که در کعبش دمی فربه نماید. الا تا نشنوی مت سخنگوی که اندک مای نفعی است و دارد که گر روزی مرادش بر نیاری دو صد چندان عیوبت بر شمارد. This is about sycophants. You know, there are people who are flatterers, sitting, you know, cap in hands. You know, they're around you. Right, they're sucking up to you. As long as you give them something, the moment you say I don't have it, they will leave you, and they will, God knows what, say about you. Do not fall for the trick of an enemy, nor should you buy the praise of a sycophant, as this has set a snare of provisions. And that has opened the skirt of covetousness. A fool is puffed up with flattery like the carcass of an animal which appears corpulent when you blow into its heel. Take heed not to listen to the sycophant's flattery as he's seeking his own interest by that cajolery. Shouldst thou someday fail to fulfill his wishes, he will enumerate in thee 200 blemishes.
Right. I have good news. Only 3 years left.
Right. ده آدمی بر سفره‌ای بخورند و دو سگ بر مرداری با هم به سر نبرند. حریص با جهانی گرسنه است و قانع به نانی سیر. حکما گفتند توانگری به قناعت به هست توانگری به بضاعت. روده تنگ, whatever.
Okay, so I just read the English.
10 people will partake of the same food at a table. But 2 dogs will not put up with each other over a carrion. The greedy man is still hungry with the whole world put in front of him. And the contented person is satisfied with a loaf of bread. The sage have said, affluence of continence is better than opulence of abundance. The narrow intestine will be filled with only a bread of rye. But the whole world's abundance cannot satisfy a greedy eye. His life being expired, my father ready to depart, to me this very piece of advice he did impart. Abstain from lust, as it is nothing but fire. To go to hell thou shouldst not aspire, as burning in that fire is beyond thy tolerance. Extinguish it today with the water of continence.
This is it. Thank you.
Okay. خشم بیش از حد گرفتن وحشت آرد و لطف بی وقت هیبت ببرد. نه چندان درشتی کن که از تو سیر گردند و نه چندان نرمی که بر تو دلیر شوند. درشتی و نرمی به هم در به هست. چو فاسد, فاسد with sod, phlebotomist. چو فاسد که جراح و مرهم نه هست. درشتی نگیرد خردمند پیش, نه سستی که ناقص کند قدر خیش. نه مر خیشتن را فزونی نهد, نه یک بار تن در مزلت دهد. شبانی با پدر گفت ای خردمند, مرا تعلیم ده پیرانه یک پند به گفتا نیک مردی کن نچندان که گردد خیره گرگ تیز دندان.
Excessive wrath will bring about fear and enmity. An untimely kindness will mar dignity. Do not be so harsh that will make them fed up with you, and so lenient that will embolden them. If thou art tough, better be at the same time lenient. Like a phlebotomist who scarifies and applies an unguent. A prudent person will not exert austerity, nor will he let his clemency mar his dignity. He will neither demonstrate superiority, nor will he stoop to abject inferiority. O sage, said a shepherd to his father, give me a maxim expected of the sagacious. He replied, be benevolent, but not to the extent that the sharp-fanged wolf may become audacious.
Yeah, thank you.
And the last, not least.
Okay.
They say, بر عجز دشمن رحمت مکن که اگر قادر شود بر تو نبخشاید. دشمن چو بینی ناتوان لاف از بروت خود مزن. بروت means civil, mustache.
Right. Do I still have it?
دشمن چو بینی ناتوان لاف از بروت خود مزن. مغزی است در هر استخوان، مردی است در هر پیرهن.
Have no mercy on a subdued foe, for if he regains his power, he will show you no mercy. When thou seest thy enemy unable to make an attempt, boast not by curling thy mustache at him in contempt. For in every skull there is a mind, and in every garb a man you will find.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. And I do believe that as long as tyranny, oppression, and despotism exist and they are not uprooted, as long as famine, hunger, and starvation are not extirpated, as long as nations and ignorance exist, and this unbridgeable chasm between the social classes deepen day after day, Saadi remains dateless, timeless, and ageless. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Now I'm ready to answer any question if there is. Yeah. Do we still have? No more. So we can finish. I thought. Yeah. Right. I mean, does it necessarily have to be up to 6 o'clock or something? No. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye bye. Yes, sure.
Where did you learn English so well?
Well, in Iran. Yeah, that is. Yes, I learned it there, but I had the chance of having American teachers. Of course, British teachers I also had. But for a while, I was really in a twilight zone. I didn't know. I had an American teacher at the same time, a British one. In this class, I should say, I can't do that. I can't. And it was really hard. I say, well, here it was either, there it was either. And but anyway, it was English. I had American teachers, American students, American colleagues, and self-study, that's it. Well, as Siavai said, I've done different things. I'm jack of all trades, but master of none. You know, whatever the door was open, I went in, right? And well, this is self-study. I guess that's the only way we can learn. Okay. Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much,
Dr. Haas. It's really more than a pleasure to have you sitting in front of me. More than encouraging. Right. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, sure.
Sorry, I couldn't hear you, actually.
What? Isn't it better to translate into your native language?
Yeah, I heard. You know, the fact is that this is exactly what why I did this. I mean, translators usually are more comfortable translating things into their mother tongue. I mean, when the we have a source language and target language, right? Generally, the target language is the mother tongue. And to do it the other way around is a strenuous job, as I did. Yeah, that would have been much easier for me to do that, from English into Persian. But there has to be somebody to do, I mean, to take this risk, to take this chance. And I was probably the one who broke this ice. Right, thank you. Yeah, it's really much easier for because, you know, we do have a lot of translators, but they have all translated things from English or, I don't know, different languages, French into Persian. It is just a piece of hotcakes, so much easier. But to do it the other way around, you have to have a relative command, at least. And if not an absolute one, absolute, I guess nobody has it except God. I'm not sure. I haven't asked them. Right. Probably, yeah. Right. So that's fine. Okay. Yes, sir.
When will your translations be published?
Next year, hopefully. Bear the emblem of UNESCO on it. Yes. It's going to be probably with UNESCO, as CLI said. And just the introduction is left. You know, I take my time. It's not something mechanical. You know, it's not mechanical at all. I mean, I cannot say that, okay, today I'll go home and do it. No. You know, sometimes, just for a word, you know, this is one of the questions asked me once and other people. They say, did you ever resort to a thesaurus or something? Well, sometimes I did. But most of the times, I depended on my own vocabulary. So for days and days, I was just looking for the mot juste for the exact word. You know, there are lots of words, but you know, connotation is very important. I mean, this is the very word. I mean, we do have different types of language. You know, we have formal, informal, standard, non-standard, jargon, slang. But if it is formal, it has to be translated. That's why I use thou or thee or something. Just poems. Because I wanted it to be redolent of that time. That's it. But the text, no. But the poem, right. Yeah. And hopefully next year. I mean, by the end of, in about 12 months, you're going to have a beautiful copy in your hand. Yes. And I'm going to read it, the e-book. Because it's all right. They say it has to be right. This is right. And then the people will have to suffer. Well, this is fishing for compliments, but nobody did that. It's a wave.
Okay. Anything else? No?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. 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 Thank you.